everyone. I'm Jen Zoe, and this is Maverick. You already know a little bit about him, but he's been having a little bit of a time connecting with me this morning because he's out in a big open space, and I obviously don't have any rope on, so he can kind of go wherever he wants to go. So when he decided to connect with me, I was like, yay! But also, he was in a position where he really wasn't sure that he wanted to connect with me. And he was like, I think I might be able to jump this. I don't know, because this fence isn't too terribly tall. The irony about that is that it's taken me a long time to build the confidence in him to be able to jump this height at all. Because he was a racehorse. As you know, he's a little bit of his story. He won over $500,000 at the track. He won more money than Seabiscuit. And they run on a flat surface that's very well groomed, and that's it, in a circle. So as a racehorse or as a person, if that's all you know, anybody here work in corporate? And you have, you know, he goes, yeah, corporate jobs. So if you're in a place where you like have had a job your whole life, you know, going out and having the opportunity to share ideas and be expressive and do something other than what you were told to do can be very challenging. All right, I think we're good. So I really have been spending a lot of time just telling him he's okay exactly how he is, and he doesn't have to run the rat race anymore. He doesn't have to go and be that hero for someone else's dream or vision. Because did he win that $500,000 for himself? No. In fact, it's the people that won the money turned him out to a rescue when he was done. And he's one of the lucky ones. You guys know that my mission is here about saving horses and changing lives. Well, not all racehorses are so lucky to end up at a beautiful sanctuary with a beautiful retirement. Some of them end up on the floor of a slaughterhouse, and that is not okay with me. The lucky thing about horses like him is that he ends up with people like me. And now he can start to feel more and more confident to connect with me and follow me as his leader. And the interesting thing about that is that we already know that mavericks need trust. And trust is built in the smallest of moments. It's like a beach, like these tiny grains of sand on a beach. Some of the most beautiful beaches in the world, that's what we're made up of. So if over time you continually show up in a reliable way, in a way where you hold yourself accountable, in a way where you don't judge, you know, when they fall apart. You know, you have these opportunities to respect his boundaries and express your own boundaries in a healthy way. Like, all of these things start to build trust. And he doesn't have to be with me. In fact, in the beginning, he kind of wasn't. He decided he wanted to trot around and go do different things. But we're going to see if we can have a conversation with him now. Because a lot of times, especially when we're dealing with the Bellas and the Mavericks of the world, we're like, oh my gosh, remember last session? Do we constantly have to be reminding Bellas that they're okay, they're okay, they're okay? Well, yeah, until they can believe it themselves. Or if you don't want to be with a Bella that isn't okay, then don't. But don't put yourself in a position to be in a relationship with someone that you aren't willing to put the time, effort, and energy to figure out what is going on with them so you can put their needs as your own. And you go first. In my mastermind, we talk about this in a very deep way, about the responsibilities of each individual of the relationship and how you can reverse engineer back to what could possibly be broken or misaligned. Let's put it that way. So Maverick is very much of a feeler, whereas Bella was a dreamer. And he's very just sort of a stoic, regal kind of character when he's centered. When he's not, he starts to shut down. There, good boy. Remember the lick and chew. Remember what that means. It means that they are processing something. Like there's a new piece of information that they go, oh, that makes sense to me. Now, sometimes, especially when we get to Dante, it might not be something good, but it's definitely something. So we're looking at Maverick here and we go, what is going on in his brain? Sometimes these are really challenging demos to do because it's like watching paint dry to go, did you see his eyelash move? That meant so much. Because with horses like and people like Maverick, the little things mean so much to them on the inside. And I have a dear friend of mine, and she's really incredible, but her her ability to express herself is somewhat challenged because she is very shy or shut down or quiet, and probably was taught to be that way by her parents. Because where do belief systems, BS, right? Where do our belief systems come from? They come from the things that we're taught by the people that we surround ourselves with, the media, our political beliefs, our interactions with each other, what we were born with. It's kind of crazy to think, but you were inside your grandmother. You know, we're all women. We're all born with our eggs. And so we were actually in our grandmother's womb, if you think about it. That's it. I love that sigh. So I sit here and I tell a few stories and I share with you some things as he gets more calm. I'm not doing this for you. I'm doing this for him. Luckily, I have a lot of stories. But if I didn't, I'd have to get some because I can't just go in and start working with him until I feel him feel him start to come out of his shell. And notice how slow I'm moving. Because in order to get to an introvert's feet, you have to get to their mind. If you remember in Bella's video, oh my gosh, how much did we have to move her feet in order to get to her mind, right? So I'll say it cleanly this way. In order to get to an introvert's feet, you have to get to their mind and their heart. In order to get to an extrovert's mind, you have to move their feet. And at that part, if you remember, we were going back and forth and back and forth. She was like, what? Oh yeah, put my phone down, pay attention, right? And I can be okay. So I'm gonna go really slow with him and we'll see what shows up. I don't have any sort of pretense or ideals about what I think he should do. I have a plan about what I'd like him to do, but I want him to be comfortable first. Oh, now he offered that, so I'll take it. Hi, baby. And as he was like, oh, I want to make sure that, yeah, that's okay. And start slow. So in the workplace, these are the ones you just want to give them, like send them an email, or if you're in sales and you're wanting to work with one of these guys, you send them a lot of love, right? A lot of things that move them emotionally, help them feel a certain way. Because we don't care how, you know, people don't care what you tell them. They won't remember that. But they will remember how you make them feel. And if you make them feel like rushed or judged or uncared for, it won't matter what words you used. So with these guys, you send them love and then back off. And in sales, I would say, when in doubt, lean out. So notice how much different he is, how slow he's moving. Can you believe this horse was a racehorse? Look how slow he is. Now, that's given the choice. In his corporate career, he did not have a lot of choices. He didn't have any choices, honestly. They put a person on his back. I say a monkey. Put a little monkey on his back, gave that monkey a whip, put him on a track, and ran him around a circle his whole life. He was raised in France and Canada, Churchill Downs and Keeneland. He was raced till he was almost 11 years old. Which is criminal, you guys. To race a horse for that long is just... And it's incredible that he is sound, healthy, and fit at almost 20 years of age. So we look at him, and I go, now he's not going to have to be someone's circus pony anymore. Like, that's not what he's about. And what value can he bring by teaching you about trust, about patience? These horses were the most challenging for me to understand. And when I had to, when my white horse Trace, who you'll see next session, got laid up with an injury, I had to get another horse to further my professional career as a professional horse trainer and a professional instructor. And her name was Daisy, and she was very aptly named. She's a little quarter horse named Daisy, and she was this personality. And what happened on the way out to where I was headed, I was out to going on my way to Colorado, had a trailer full of horses, and I stopped in Missouri to visit my sister-in-law, and she didn't have the best quality of fence, and little Daisy went through the fence and just shredded her chest, like just flayed her open. It was horrible. And this isn't my horse, this is a friend's horse I'm borrowing, so I'm going to train the horse, get my stuff. And I was like, oh my God, now what? So I drove to the vet, got her stitched up. It wasn't serious injuries, they weren't deep, but they were definitely bad enough that I wasn't going to be able to ride her, work with her. So I was out in Colorado for 6 weeks, right? And that's how long the time I had to be able to do this performance and do these, jump through these hoops and do what I was supposed to do with a horse. And I got out there and couldn't do any of it. So I felt kind of like the little kid with violin lessons while everybody else is outside in the yard playing, you know, playing baseball. I'm like, ah, because I could only like care for her. I wasn't able to ride, couldn't do anything for the first good chunk of the sessions. So all I did was hang out with her. I fed her, we went for walks, I groomed her, I scooped her poo. And guess what happened with a maverick type horse named Daisy when you go in and just love on them with no expectation, no pretense, no let's go do this. Every day I went and just cared for her. The part of her brain that would scan for when is the other shoe going to drop? When is she going to come at me? When is she going to judge me? When is she going to kick me to go and pull me to stop? Sound familiar, any of you? If you're a maverick, you know this. You're waiting. You're waiting for that inevitable bad thing to happen. But as we got acquainted and I kept telling her, you're fine. I'm not doing anything. I couldn't. I was dying. As an extrovert, I was like, everybody's learning this stuff and I'm not learning anything and it's terrible. What's going on, buddy? What's going on? And so at the end of her healing, she looked at me as somebody she could trust. And those small moments before dawn when I would go and just pet her and be with her. And by the time she was physically better, and I could ride and work and play with her, I had changed, and so had she. Because I realized that what she needed was those moments of stillness and understanding, just like this one. And ironically, when I got on and started riding and had to perform and do all these fancy, technique-y type of things, all I had to do was ask. She was so willing and soft and believing and trusting in me because I didn't ask her or push her or force her to do anything. But all I had to do was direct her. And that's the easy part. Asking them what to do is the easy part. Getting them to be feel safe and trusting and motivated and obedient and willing and exuberant, that's the tough part. And that's the same thing with people. It's not about, can you take out the trash? That's easy. You get up, pick up thing, got stuff, put it in there, done. That's the easy part. The technique is the easy part. It's this. It's finding their heart. It's building that trust. It's coming in and connecting with them at the soul level, understanding their needs and putting their needs above your own in order to develop that level of a relationship that we all dream of. And so the same thing happened when I got this horse. He had a little injury to his foot, nothing serious. And it was a beautiful opportunity to practice something called the Ho'oponopono prayer. And it's very simply put, I'm sorry, please forgive me, I love you, thank you. And some people would ask me, like, why are you apologizing to him? You didn't do anything. What do you need forgiveness for? You just got this horse. So I say, I'm sorry that I look or resemble anything that might have caused you pain, or that I might look like the same duck that ducked me over, right? I want to say, I'm sorry that they look anything like that, that I'm a part of something that did cause you pain or suffering. Please forgive me for any mistakes that I have made in the past that I don't know about, or any that I would make in the future. And then I love you. Of course, I love you. How could you not love him? He's not gorgeous. Thank you. Thank you for the honor of the opportunity so I can learn and grow as a person and serve people at my highest and best, and so you can be at your highest and best too. So we said that to him every single day, And I promised them, I said, I promise I will never force you. I will never ask you to do anything that you wouldn't be 100% comfortable or willing to do and build the confidence to do so. I will never force you to run. I will never force you to jump. I will never force you, period. And as I told him these things and just really felt and emulated that with him every single day, and his foot started to heal, it was the same that had happened with little Daisy. And we had people come that had never been on a horse. And part of why I ended up with him is that he was dangerous. He was done. Remember, freeze then explode. He had frozen and exploded, and he was rearing over on people, and he was just like, so they just chucked him in a stall, you know, just left him to be. When he has obviously so much talent left in him. Yeah, right, baby? But we took that time. We said, we're not going to do that. I know. No. And when we go up, people that had never been on a horse, never been around horses, are now riding him bareback with a halter and just being like connecting with him. So that's what I would say when you're dealing with your Mavericks. And if you are a Maverick, is your heart not singing? Like, could you possibly go, oh my God, it would be such an incredible relationship to have if somebody understood me at that level, understood that I just need to be, feel okay so I can be okay, so I can relax that part of my brain that's waiting for the other shoe to drop. So I'm going to work with him now that he's kind of sort of come around and like get a little more connected and he's not as worried. Let's see what we got. Cause that's the thing. I want my horses to say, I want my people too. I want them to say, I would do whatever you're asking or die trying, knowing that you would never ask me to do anything that I would have to die trying to do. So we're just going to see if he can trot around the poles a little. And then remember, he doesn't have any, like, jumping is not his thing. But we have a little jump out here. And it's obvious that he's very physically capable. But look how calm he is. Yeah, good boy. Putting pressure on them is a big deal. Cantering for him is a big deal. He's gallop. He can go flat out. But cantering's a whole different thing. So we'll see what shows up. I'm just going to move with him and see what he offers. Let him get those big long legs moving. My short little T-Rex. I got T-Rex arms and little stubby legs. What can I am not stand a chance with these guys. I'll just allow him to move, and then I'll bring my energy down and allow him to relax. He's kind of got it holding his breath just a little, so I'm going to let him work through that. That's it. Good boy. Come across that top line and relax that part of his body. And then ask him to go a little faster. Like, that's hard for him. And then ask him to go a little slower and back off. Remember, with Mavericks, when in doubt, lean out. Right? So I bring my energy up. Give him a little bit of encouragement. I would never, we're not whacking him. Just encouragement, a little energy behind. And then I'll relax and allow him to relax. And then I'll start putting it on a pattern and I'll move with him. Like, let him know I'm not here just asking him to do stuff. I'm here with him as his partner. Like, I'll work with you as you build more confidence. And then right as he goes past the pole, I'll give him a little encouragement. And his head comes up. I'm like, ooh, don't want him to be worried. Relax. Back off. When in doubt, lean out. See if he can get a little more speed, and then relax. Let him tune into my energy and connect with me from that space. Are you Mavericks out there? You watching? Here we go, right as we come up to this pole. I'll pick up my speed, bring in my energy. Give him a little encouragement. And if I don't get it, that's okay. Guess what? I'm getting my steps in today. And I'm connecting with him, because that's what it's about. Try again. And then come back down. So I'll do this a few more times, see where we're at. Just put it on a pattern. Remember, be patient. There's a lick and chew. Bring my energy up. And I'm not, I don't care if I get it or not. That's the detachment. I will get it because I'm certain. But I don't care and I'm not attached to the outcome. In the mastermind, we talk about that. Express your desire. Set your intention. Do your best and detach from the outcome. Because he may not be ready for this today. And I have to be okay with that. Ladies, if your man's not ready to ask you to marry him, you can't get you a little orange stick and force it. Or pee on a stick. That's even worse. We do it though, don't we, ladies? That is manipulation. We are not going to put ourselves into any sort of manipulation. I want this to, I want it to be their idea. I'm gonna watch and wait, make sure he's still relaxed. That is, as long as he can come up. I might let him go one more lap. Might even slow him down a little. That's it. That's it. Good boy. Good boy. Yeah, he knows. Good boy. Good boy. Because I could. Easily. All I have to do is whack him. He knows that game. Get on my back and whack me till I'm run. But I want it to be his idea. So I give him a break. And we try again. Make it a game. Has to be playful. When he can know that that's all I want and he can offer it on his terms instead of mine, then I don't have to always be asking, hey baby, did you get me roses this week? Hey baby, did you buy me chocolates for Valentine's Day? Hey baby, da 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 da. It's like, all you have to do is make the suggestion. And when there's trust and the bonding is there, it shows up. This goes for work, goes with your kids, anytime you are or are dealing with a maverick, right? Building that trust, building that bond, coming from that stoic place. I hope you got a lot out of this one, guys. Trust is such a deep topic and a word that gets wielded around like so, with so much weight and meaning. When you break it down and understand what it really takes, then you can learn that when you can trust, there's a part of your brain that relaxes and you can feel comfortable and aligned and connected. Right, baby? You wanna go jump the jump? We're gonna go jump the jump. I want to break free.